want you to know how God is real, man. When you pray and you seek him, sometimes he answers quickly. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer, but he always answers. Amen. We just have to be patient and wait and trust that he's going to come through. Amen. So let's go ahead and open our Bibles to Acts chapter 27. And we're going to be looking at verses 9 through 31. And I'm not going to read all the verses, but I will encourage you guys to go and read them at home, you know, and just kind of get a feel of the story. But I will give you guys certain things from these passages, from these verses, just so I can develop with you this study on storms. You know, the book of Acts is an amazing book, isn't it? I mean, think about it with me. The book of Acts, in the book of Acts, we have the birth of the church, right? We also see how the early church began to multiply. But it also tells us some awesome and amazing stories, right? I mean, sometimes when I'm reading through the book of Acts, I'm just blessed of how God poured out his spirit and began to work amongst his people. How people were getting healed, people were getting saved. I mean, God was doing a great work. And then you come to this one character by the name of the Apostle Paul. I don't know about you, but I have two characters in the book of Acts that I really love. One of them is Stephen, right? Because he's down for Christ. He loses his life. Literally, he goes out in the blaze of glory, right? And then the Apostle Paul, another guy, man. One of the things that encouraged me about Paul is that not only was he down for the Lord. What I mean by that, this guy was willing to give everything for God. But I love that fact. Remember when he's preaching the gospel, they take him out, they beat him down, and they leave him almost dead, right? And the apostles are like, oh, man, he died. And then Paul gets up, dusts himself up, out, and then he starts going forward preaching the gospel. When I read stuff like that, it motivates me. I say to myself, man, Lord, help me not to use excuses like my leg hurts, right? You know, I got a sore throat. To use these excuses from sharing the gospel. To be willing to go all out just to tell people about the love of God and how in Christ there is hope. Well, today I want to look into a story about regarding the Apostle Paul. In fact, in the book of Acts, you know, we're told of his missionary journeys, right? In Acts 27, in this book that we have before us, we're told that Paul went on a ship which sailed into a very strong and dangerous storm. Now, this story of Paul riding out this storm gives us some insight into how we ought to ride out storms in our lives. Now, the question that I want to put out there for you guys is very simple. Why would God use almost the entire chapter here in this book, in the book of Acts, to talk about a storm and a ship that goes into this storm? Well, the reason why I believe is because this chapter is more than just history. It's his story and how great God is and how he protects, how he saves, and how he uses his people to do great works. And we're going to look into that today. Now, I want you to note another thing. This chapter illustrates every person in the world sailing through storms in their lives. You know, some things that I've also noted is that sometimes the storms are different in every one of our lives. Some are strong, some are soft, right? But through those storms, we learn a lot. We learn a lot. Now, as a Christian, as believers, we have someone that's going to carry us through the storms, right? His name is Christ, Jesus Christ. He helps us through the storms in life. But through those storms, God matures us, right? He develops us. But not only that, he also corrects us. I mean, there's various reasons why God allows us through storms. So when we're going through storms, we know that God is with us. But for the unbeliever, it's kind of sad when you think about it. When they don't have a relationship with God, they pretty much go through a storm on their own. And we see the aftermath of that. And today we're going to see how unbelievers go through, how they handle storms, and how Christians handle their storms. But in this story, Paul has been taken to prison for preaching the gospel. And they are taking him to Rome to stand trial before Caesar. Now, when Paul started out his journey, we saw him as a prisoner on this ship. But at the end of the story, you're going to see how he's no longer a prisoner, but the captain of that ship, as the Lord would turn things around for his glory and honor. Now, Paul was one who saw opportunity in every difficulty. Listen, Paul was one who saw opportunity in every difficulty. Not like us, though, huh? Sometimes we see difficulty in every opportunity. But Paul was the opposite. Paul was always, because he was a man that was in love with God, and that's what he did. He talked about God. He talked about Christ. His heart was to win souls, which would be every believer's desire, is to see people get saved. So whenever an opportunity rose up, Paul will take it and use it for the glory of God. So he used every opportunity, every difficulty as an opportunity to share God. In fact, he will later write in 2 Corinthians 2:14, he wrote, "Now thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ, and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place." Well, that was Paul as he wrote those words. So before we begin, listen closely. I want to kind of take you quickly to verse 20 through 25. So right there in chapter 27, look with me in verse 20. We'll read together to verse 25. And I want you to note a couple things. Now notice, it says, "Now when neither sun nor stars," Acts 27:20, "appear for many days, and no salt tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. But after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, 'Men, you should have listened to me and not have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of God to whom I belong and whom I serve," speaking about the Lord, "saying, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar. And indeed, God has granted you all those who sail with you.' Therefore," he says, "take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told me." Now notice that. So again, we look here in this particular passage as Paul describes this big storm in verse 20. We have here four reasons for these kinds of storms that happens to believers and to unbelievers. Now, the first thing I want you to notice is there is the norm storms that come to everyone simply because they are part of this fallen world. Storms come to everyone, right? Believers and unbelievers. In fact, Jesus said in Matthew 5:45, he said, "For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and on the unjust." Listen, as humans, we all live in a world that has the sun and rain, and all humans will experience some storms simply because we're here living in this fallen world, right? Then there's number two. Then there is the storms that we produce ourselves because of our foolish decisions, right? Or our disobedience to God. Because of foolish decisions and disobedience to God, we produce these storms in our lives. We inflict, you know, pain in our lives, regret in our lives, because we don't obey God's word, or we just simply make foolish decisions. And a good example is the man Jonah. Remember Jonah? Jonah is the perfect illustration of a man who bailed on God, right, and put himself outside of the will of the Lord. In fact, running from the Lord led him to a storm. And finally, he found himself in a well of trouble. Amen? Jonah chapter 1, verse 2. You can read the story. And how many of us have done that, right? God tells us to do certain things. We do the opposite. And then we find ourselves in a mess, in a hole. And we're wondering, why, God? Why did you do this? And God said, "Nah, Charlie, you don't say me. It was you. You made that decision," right? So we end up making these foolish decisions, right? And simply because we disobey God. So there's these storms that we produce ourselves. And then number three, there's also the storms that God sends down our way to mature us. These type of storms by God make good for our development. It makes good for our development. Remember when Jesus sent his disciples into a storm at the sea? Because he was trying to teach them a lesson to help them grow in discipleship. You can read about it in Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. I want you to know that these are the storms. There are times we get into a storm, not because we're outside of God's will, like Jonah, but because we are in God's will, like the disciples. You hear me? There's some, right, that are in the will of God, and storms come. And God uses those things to build us up. You know, we always pray, "Oh, Lord, we want to be just like you." Well, watch what you pray for, because Jesus will say, "I got you. I got you. You know, I'm forgiving," right? And you say, "Yeah, well, guess what? I'm going to bring your enemy to your life." someone to backstab you and talk about you and do you wrong. And guess what? I want you to forgive him. Or I want you to forgive her. But Lord, no, but you pray for it. Now here he goes. So he uses storms in our lives to develop us, to make us like into the image of his son, which we have been predestined to be, Christ's likeness. Amen? Then there's number four. Then there are those storms that we're just simply dragged into, you know? And this is where we find the Apostle Paul. You see, Paul was a seasoned traveler who had been, you know, through many shipwrecks. He knew that this ship shouldn't have sailed and tried to warn the people, but they didn't listen to him. As a prisoner who was being guarded, you know, by a Roman centurion, Paul knew he had to go simply because, you know, he was bound and he was instructed to follow. And there are times that we find ourselves in storms that are not our making. We simply are born into them, right? Kind of like children, right? They are dragged into a storm because of ungodly parents, you know, who probably made some unwise decisions. And now they have to live it out. You know, it wasn't their fault. Someone else made those decisions, but they were brought into it. Or what about us like adults? We're dragged into a storm because of the authorities that are over us. You know, as Americans, listen closely. We get thrown into a storm because of bad leadership. We find ourselves sailing into judgment due to laws and rules, listen, that have passed in Congress, that our president has passed, or the judges. Sometimes we just get dragged into these storms. Amen? We sometimes wish we can do something, but in reality, there's not much we can do because we're limited. So like Paul, who didn't want to sail, we're just on board as prisoners, riding into the storms with others. But here's a good thing. Jesus was with Paul, just like he's with us. And we're going to see that as we get further into our study. Now notice what it says in verses 9 through 11. It says, now when much time had been spent and sailing was now dangerous because the fast was already over, Paul advised them. He's saying, men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only of the cargo and ship, but also our lives. Nevertheless, the centurion was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship than by the things spoken by Paul. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to set sail from there also, if by any means they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete opening toward the southwest and northwest, and winter there. Again, we note here that Paul didn't want to sail, but he didn't have a choice. He was at the mercy, hear me, of others making that decision. On one side, you have the helmsman, the captain of the ship, the owner, who were both worldly men, businessmen that were simply motivated by profit and led by worldly wisdom. And on the other hand, you have the Apostle Paul, a man of God, a man who had a spiritual radar, a spiritual radar, right? They're telling them, hey, listen, this is not going to end good, right? So here you have him with the spiritual radar. Between them was the centurion who was decision maker. He chose not to listen to this religious prisoner, but foolishly and ignorantly chose to listen to the worldly men. And we see that in verse 11. The decision to sell was a big and deadly mistake, right? It was a big and deadly mistake. Just like many today are in danger of making the same bad decision, which can lead to a deadly storm. Listen closely. Are you going to sail into a storm out of disobedience or ignorance and not into the storms that would mature us in the things of God? I want to give you five ways and how you can make bad decisions. Number one, I'm going to be giving you number one, number two around the message. So you jot them down. Number one, you can make a bad decision when you rush a decision. When you rush a decision. Notice verse 9. It says, now when much time has been spent. Notice that. They probably said something like this. This is going too fast, man. We better do something real quick. Have you ever found yourself doing that? Making quick decisions? A lot of people make life decisions, listen, without waiting on the Lord for guidance. They'll say something like this. Let's just decide already, even if it's wrong. They'll quit school, right? They'll quit their job. They'll leave the church, right? Or maybe leave the city. They'll move to another town or et cetera. They make these quick decisions, not realizing, man, that what you should have done is wait on God. Seek the Lord. What if the Lord wants to do something there? What if the Lord wants to work something in your life there? But because you see the storm coming, you freak out, you panic, and you bail on God rather than waiting on God. Have you done that? Have you bailed on a relationship? You know, have you quit a job? You know, have you left the church? You know, have you ever prayed? I trip out when people leave our church, you know. They live, number one, some of them are in sin, and then they say, well, the Lord is calling me. I say, why can't you call him, man? You're in sin. I know what you're doing, man. And then I'll ask them a question like this. Well, why will the Lord tell you to leave someone when he just brought you here? Interesting. And why would you go to another church when, man, they're fully staffed? I mean, they got all these servants, and here we're asking for people to come and serve in the inner city. Why would God do that? Find out later that a lot of these people that left were not really seeking the Lord. They were seeking comfort. Or they were in sin and they got exposed and they just wanted to go hide. Or for very reason. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that God's not going to tell you to leave the church or anything like that. But I'm saying is this. Make sure it's God and not you. Because you might be missing out in what God has for you where he has you. You with me? So sometimes we make bad decisions because we rush those decisions. Again, listen, there is no real guidance from God. When you don't seek God and there's no real guidance from the Lord, you can find yourself in a deadly storm. So again, if you're in the middle of a decision, I plead with you, wait on the Lord and he will come and show you what to do. Amen. Now, God's Spirit will guide you. God's Spirit will lead you. He will never shove you into anything, man. That's the enemy. You let the Lord put you where he needs to, and you just got to wait on him, and he'll make sure he directs you that path. Number two, so, you know, first one is rushing a decision. Number two, how about this one? Leaning on worldly wisdom and not on the wisdom of God's word. Leaning on worldly wisdom and not on the wisdom from God's word, which is Christ. Notice verse 11. It says, nevertheless, the centurion was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship than by the things spoken by Paul. Now, Paul was a man of God. Think about it. We're talking about the man who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament was on that ship with them. And God has spoken to him already. He had insight. And he's talking to them. And he's saying, man, listen, not only is God, you know, has spoken to me, but I also have experience. You know, I know the weather. I know how these storms work. And he's giving them wisdom, and they reject him. They reject him, and they listen to the wisdom of the others, the worldly individuals. Again, church, do not get your counsel from the world. Get your counsel from the word of God. Forsake any advice from the world. Please, I beg you. It trips me out how sometimes, you know, Christians will go to worldly counselors rather than godly counselors. You know, I read about a man who, this one man who went to a psychiatrist, you know, to help him in their marriage. But this guy has been divorced 4 times, remarried 4 times. Think about it. What do you think he's going to tell him? See, we need to be wise. The world's going to tell you, man, bail on her, right? Or bail on him, man. You know, if you don't love them, then, you know, you deserve to be loved. You deserve to be accepted. You deserve to be praised or whatever, right? Take off on them, man. It's okay. You need to be happy. That's what the world will tell you. But the word will say, nah, man, you fight for your marriage. You love her like Christ loved the church. If you're a wife, he'll tell you, you respect your husband. You see that you submit to him as unto the Lord. You see what I'm saying? They go to the world and they're getting bad counsel. What about this? They go to their nana or their tia, right, or their grandma, and they're not even Christians. But it's my family. They love me. God loves you more. You should be turning to the word of God where you're going to receive the counsel that you need to make that marriage succeed. Man, I'm turning into a rapper up here. But we need to not seek the counsel of the world. But we need to see this. We need to seek the counsel of the word of God. Listen, if you do, Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 tells us you're going to be blessed. And I've said this before, but if you don't, you'll be a mess. See, I'm rapping already. Number three, how about this one? Trying to take the easy way out. Notice verse 12. Because the harbor was not suitable to winter in or to spend the winter. They weren't comfortable. So they made their decision based on what would be the easiest for them. Listen, we'll almost always get into trouble if we make decisions based on what is easiest. Do you know that we're told in Scripture in 2 Timothy 2:3 that we are to endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ and not to take the easy way out? Some of us don't want to endure that hardship. But little do you realize that in enduring that hardship, hear me? As I mentioned earlier, man, God is working in you to eventually work through you. What if God has allowed you to go through that hardship because through your faithfulness and your commitment and love for God, God's going to use it to bring someone to the Lord? Maybe there's someone in your family who's questioning God, who's wondering whether this is real or not, but they're taking note of you. They're observing you. They got their eye on you, man. And as you're being faithful, God, you know, opens their eyes to see, listen, Christianity is real. It's not fake. There are people that do love me and do trust me. And guess what? Look at their life. They'll be blessed. So here's the thing. God has called you and I to endure hardships as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, not to take the easy way out like many have. They bail on their marriages. Why go through all the trouble, man? I'm glad me and my wife didn't do that, man. I'm glad we didn't listen to the world, but that we listened to the Word of God. Because if we would have bailed out, we would have never experienced what we're experiencing today. Being used by God, man, it blesses my heart when I see my wife teach the Word. She's an anointed woman, man. And to see her bring the Word the way she does, I'm like, oh, man, thank God I stuck around. And vice versa, I hope she says the same to me when she goes to the women's conference. So you guys let me know if she doesn't. But anyways, number four, how about this one? You can make bad decisions when you listen to the majority. Notice verse 12. It says that the majority advised to set sail. There was a crowd of 276 with Paul included. And when they took a vote, according to verse 37, there was 276. They outvoted Paul here, you see? Following the crowd, listen closely, can cause you to make bad decisions. You hear me? They can cause you to make bad decisions. Know that the majority is always, almost always wrong. Remember in Numbers chapter 12 to chapter 13? Remember the 12 spies that told Joshua not to invade the land? But there was two that said, come on, let's go take it. 10 of them were wrong. The majority was wrong. The two were right. What about in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 10? We read of the story of Saul. The people wanted Saul to be king of Israel. God didn't, but God gave them what they wanted. And later on, they turned out they didn't want what they got, right? The reality is the majority was wrong. Or what about in Matthew 27, 20-22? The people wanted Barabbas released. And they wanted Jesus crucified, which led to the most heinous crime ever committed by mankind. You hear me? You can make some bad decisions when you listen to the majority. Don't listen to the majority. Listen to God. Pray that God would open your ears so that you can be sensitive to when the Spirit speaks to you. And even when it doesn't make sense, do it anyway. Because afterwards, it will make sense. You hear me? I mean, when does God ever make sense? When he asks us to do some things, right? But he knows what he's doing. He's God. His ways are not our ways, man. Right? So we need to learn to listen to the Spirit. It's been said, listen, quote, do you know that the majority, let me read this again. Do you know what the majority generally is? A lot of people pulling their ignorance, unquote. All I have to say is, yep. Number five, you can make bad decisions when you trust on circumstances and not on God. Notice verse 13. when the south wind blew softly, supposing that they had obtained their desire. It says they sailed close by Crete. Seeing the sun shine, the sea was calm. The wind was blowing softly. They said, oh, it must be God's will. Let's sail, man. Let's sail. Listen, many are led by circumstances and saying, well, I prayed and I asked God and things are looking good, so it must be his will for me. These don't realize that making these decisions based on good circumstances can lead to your ship being sunk. So again, these are five things that can lead to bad decisions, to a life that can be miserable. In verses 14 through 21, I want you to notice here. I want you to know that we have the reactions to the storms of life here. Verse 14, it reads this, notice. But not long after a tremendous head wind arose, called, let me see if I can pronounce that, all right? Here we go. Euryclidon? That sounds good. Verse 15. So when the ship was caught and could not head into the wind, we let her drive. Notice that. And running under the shelter of an island called Clauda, we secured the skiff with difficulty, or the lifeboat. When they had taken it on board, they used cables to undergird the ship, and fearing lest they should run aground on the citrus sands, they struck sail, so they were driven. Notice verse 18. And because we were exceedingly tempest-tossed, the next day they lined the ship. On the third day, we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands. Now, when neither sun nor stars appeared, check this out, for many days, and a small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. But after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, men, you should have listened to me, and I have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. So here we see the reactions to these storms, or to the storms of life. First, I want you to know what happens when the unbeliever gets into a storm. I want you to know what happens. First of all, I want you to note this. Their dreams disintegrate. Their dreams disintegrate. They dissolve. Notice verse 15. It says, we let her drive. You see, the captain, the owner, the guard of the ship weren't strong enough. They weren't strong as they thought they were. So they found themselves on the ship being driven by the winds. They couldn't control it, pretty much. And this happens a lot, doesn't it? People who think they can handle a storm only to realize they're not in control, but they have lost full control of their dreams, and now their dreams are dissolving, are vanishing away. Here's the second thing. Notice their work multiplies. Their work multiplied as they began to work in desperation. We see that in verses 16 through 19. They began to do things out of desperation. They worked hard trying to desperately get everything back together. They wanted to survive. They wanted to make sure that they make it to the other side. And we see that today, how many are making desperate efforts trying to put their lives back together. That's what an unbeliever does. They'll spend money. They'll do whatever it takes just to get back everything that they've lost. Or before they lose it. They're in desperate modes, man. Listen, what they should do is come to Christ, right? They should come to Christ to work so that God may work in their lives. Listen, Jesus doesn't want you to work out things in your life. He wants you to come to him. Because when you come to him, it's when you find rest. When you come to him, it's where, you know, God gives you his peace. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 to 31, Jesus made that invitation to come to me, all you who are heavy laden. He says, and I will give you rest. Not only that, he will restore your life. Don't try to fix things. Listen, turn to the one who can fix it. Don't get in this desperation move and put all your efforts in trying to better yourself if you're a non-believer. Come to the Lord and let him do it, and then watch him give you life. But here's the thing, life more abundantly, as is recorded in John 10:10. Thirdly, the resources are all wasted. Notice verse 18, it says, and because we were exceedingly tempest-tossed, the next day they lined the ship, they threw everything overboard. In verse 21, it says, but after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, men, you should have listened to me and not have self-incurred and incurred this disaster and lost. Again, the resources are all wasted. Everything they thought was precious, they are not throwing it overboard. And today we see how unbelievers will spend the first half of their lives gathering wealth, but then they spend the second part of their life using their wealth trying to get health, right? And they end up miserable. First half and then the second half of their lives is just miserable. And listen closely. There might be some here today that will give all their possessions to have their friends back, to have their children's back, to have their families back, to have their wives back. They will do whatever it takes. They'll get rid of all that they've wasted, all that they obtain, just to get that back. That's what the world does. Fourthly, the unbeliever's hope eventually is gone. In verse 29, we read, they were praying for the day to come. But I find it interesting in verse 20 that it says, now, when neither sun nor stars appear for many days, they're out there in the sea, listen, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. Now, I want you to picture that for a moment. They're in that storm, right? They look up and they don't see the light. They don't see the sun or the moon or the stars. All they see is darkness. The waves are beating on the ship. And they say, finally, man, you know what? It's over. Hope is gone. Hope is gone. See, listen, the sun, the moon, the stars, and land disappears. So they couldn't navigate. So their hopes vanish away. Even Paul's voice was silenced in such distraction. See, the reality is they rejected God's light. Not only the stars and the stuff, but they rejected Paul, the one who had given them instruction. And now they find themselves in total darkness. And how many non-believers do that, right? They reject God's light. And because of it, they find themselves without hope. I mean, I minister in South Los Angeles. And we see many people that are just giving up. There's no hope. I mean, homelessness has just, man, plagued our city. And I'm telling you, man, but we go out there and we give them the light. And you know what's a blessing? The last couple of weeks, we've seen some homeless people come. And we loved on them. And you can see their joy, man. They respond to the gospel. But at the same time, there's those that just don't want God. They don't see the reason why. Some of them, you talk to them and you can see in their face, they lost all hope. Listen, we have that hope. And that hope is in Christ. So we give them Christ. Amen? But notice the fifth thing. Now, since they wasted their, first of all, they've wasted their resources, right? The hope is gone. And now they do what? They start doing foolish things. Notice verse 30 and 31. And as the soldiers were seeking to escape from the ship, when they had let down the skiff into the sea, the lifeboat, under pretense of putting out anchors from the prow, notice, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. They began to make some foolish decisions. There's a storm. They're thinking, you know, we'll get these lifeboats overboard, we'll jump on it, and we'll make an escape. But little did they realize, man, they could have died in that storm. The storm was too big. It was just overpowering the whole ship. There was no doubt they were going to make it alive. Listen, sometimes the unbelievers, most unbelievers, would do foolish things after they see there's no hope, after they wasted their materials, after they tried everything in their desperation. They began to do some foolish things, some bad decisions. So again, they started making plans because they don't have the lights to guide them. They start leaning on their own understanding. And ultimately, their understanding will lead to death. I mean, the Bible says in Proverbs 3:5, not to lean on our own understanding, right? But to trust in the Lord with all our hearts. With all our hearts. And then we read in Proverbs 14:12 and 16:25, there's a way that seems right to a man, but his end is death. And we see the unbelievers doing that, the unsaved, the lost. just doing things, not realizing that is leading to their death. Some of the soldiers were trying to sneak off the ship, trying to escape. So what did they do? They tried selfishly to use lifeboats that wouldn't last. And today we see how unbelievers try to escape storms they could have avoided. They turn to alcohol, right? They turn to drugs. They believe divorce is the answer. Or teens think, you know what, if I run away, that will help. Some even think just taking their own lives is the best answer for their lives. And little did they realize, man, that Satan had lied to them, had deceived them. Man, the most selfishest act that someone can do is take their own life. Take their own life. And we've seen it, man. We see, especially when we you know, through the movie industry, the music industry, we see how some of these people they end up taking their own lives. They're not satisfied. They thought that this was gonna bring them joy, but it didn't. Instead, we see them becoming alcoholics. We see them, you know, doing drugs, and ultimately, some have taken their life. Listen, if you're a non-believer here today, and you want an escape, can I encourage you? Escape to Christ. Turn to Him. He will be the one who can save you. He will be the one who can restore you. He's the one that can keep you from the storms of judgment, man. You know who's a good example? Noah. Noah was inside the ark. While the storm was going out, man was being judged. He was in the ark, which is a picture of Christ. As he was being comforted and provided for, right? He was saved in that ark. And if you're a non-believer today, listen closely. If you're hopeless right now, you're struggling, you're at a point where you're thinking, man, maybe it's better if I just end it all. Listen, don't listen to the devil. The Bible says that he comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. He wants to take your soul. But Jesus wants to give you life if you will come to him in faith. If you would just surrender your all to him, I promise you, you will have life and life more abundantly like Jesus prayed. Amen. Now notice what happens in verses 20 through to 25. We see here what happens to unbelievers in storm. But what about the believers? Well, in verse 22, it says, Paul says, now I urge you to take heart. Notice that. For there will be no loss of life among you, but only the ship. Now notice what it says in verse 25. Therefore take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told me. Now notice how he says take heart, or another translation reads take courage. Listen, and listen closely. It's a blessing to see how believers go through storms, isn't it? Because here we see, as perfectly illustrated in the life of Paul, how Paul was encouraging others. Why? Why will Paul do that? Well, you got to remember, Paul can go through the storm with a smile in his face because he just heard from God. God told him, listen, don't worry about it. No souls will be lost. Everything will be all right as long as you stay on that ship. Paul was confident in the Lord's words. God, Paul believed in the promises of his Savior. So therefore, he can go and say, listen, don't worry about it. Don't freak out. All's going to be okay. Take courage. See, believers, when they have Jesus in their lives, when we can bank on his truth, and then we can not only experience his promises, but also share them with others and give them hope. See what I'm saying? Then give them hope. That's why if you're a believer and you're going through a storm, don't tell God to get you out of the storm. Ask God to help you go through the storm so that you can gain that experience and that confidence and be able to speak hope to people that don't have what you have. But as believers, listen, we can encourage people. We can encourage people. Now, if you turn your Bibles to Psalms 107, I wonder if the Apostle Paul had this in mind when he was ministering to the people there as he was giving them these promises. Turn your Bibles to Psalms right quickly. In Psalms 107, because Paul was someone that knew the word, right? I wonder if this was going through his mind. This kind of blew my mind when I was reading it. Check this out in verse 23. And Psalms 107, verse 23. It says, those who go down to the sea in ships, who do business on great waters, they see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep, for he commanded and raises the stormy wind, which lifts up the waves of the sea. They mount up to the heavens. They go down again to the depths. Their soul melts because of trouble. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man and are at their wits' end. Then they cry out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distresses. He calms the storm so that its waves are still. Then they are glad because they are quiet. So he guides them to their desired haven. Oh, that men will give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Notice that. So we see, I wonder if Paul had that in mind. God saying, listen, you trust me. You're going to make it to Rome. You just got to believe me. And there's Paul with the promises of God telling the men, listen, take heart. Be encouraged. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. You know, my brother went through a very severe trial of the storm in his life. And I remember before he went through this storm, he was at my house. And I was able to share with him about the Lord. But my brother, because in the industry that he was, he didn't want God in his life. And he was literally at the verge of becoming an atheist. And he left my house saying, you know what, man? This is what he told me. He said that when he left, he made a decision that he will never go back to church. But I remember I talked to him and I said, you know what, bro? I love you and God loves you, man. And I'm going to pray that God will do whatever it takes to bring you back. Whatever it takes. Well, that week he went home. He got some news that was very devastating. My brother called me almost at 2 in the morning. Standing on an overpass, wanting to kill himself. And I remember I told him, bro, don't do it. I'll be there right now. I jumped out of bed after I told my wife, drove up to where he was. He's crying and he's going through this horrible storm. And for the next 2 years, all I can do is encourage him and point him to Christ. Now, man, he's in love with Christ. He preaches the gospel. This is awesome. You know why? Because I've been through those storms. And God was faithful to his word. See, as Christians, we have Christ, right? Who will help us through these storms. And we can offer word of encouragement and hope to people. And in verses 23 to 24, I want you to notice also another thing. We see the results of the storms of life. It says in 23, for there stood by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong, whom I serve. I love that. Paul says, listen, there was this angel of the Lord, right, to whom I belong and whom I serve. He understood that he was a child of God. And not only that, but he was his servant. That was his master. Verse 24 saying, do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar. And indeed, God has granted you all those who will sail with you. Here we find the results. See, God's plan was for Paul to go to Rome and to testify of God. And guess what? Paul made it to Rome. Paul made it to Rome. Again, this story is a perfect illustration of the sovereignty of God, but also man's responsibility at the same time. You see, it wasn't God's plan for the ship to sail and then to hit the storm. But I want you to know that his ultimate plan wasn't prevented by the ship sailing. You see, the ship carried God's means to minister to his people from generation to generation. You know what that was? Paul. He had Paul there. Paul would later go to write 2/3 of the New Testament. But not only that, keep in mind, the book of Acts was on board. You see, God told Paul, nothing's going to happen. See, God had plans for Paul. Paul had to make it to Rome. And we see that no matter what the enemy throws at us, listen, you can be assured that God has a specific plan for every single of our life, everyone here in this room. And God is going to see those plans out as you submit to the will of God. You just have to trust him. You have to understand, number one, that you belong to the Lord, and the Lord is not going to forsake you. He's going to be there with you. And number two, listen, you are to be his faithful servant until God calls you home. Later on, Paul will be called home, right? When Nero gives the command to kill Paul, Paul will later die being beheaded. But right before he died, he said what? I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. You see, he was untouchable, right? Until God said, now it's time for you to come home. And listen, you need to understand that the storms of life, that the storm of life might come, but God will be with you. You have to believe his word, trust in his promises, and use those things that God teaches you to bring hope and life to the world around us. Amen? So now, listen closely as I close. I want you to know that every bad decision that people make can't overrule the will of God. You hear me? Cannot overrule the will of God. It's been said, quote, we serve a mighty God, and where God does not rule, God overrules, unquote. And it's so true. You know how many times the devil tried to get me to stop fulfilling my calling? How many times he tried to disqualify me? How many times I failed, but I kept getting up? Man, you know what's crazy? That during that time, I remember, man, just thinking of Romans 5:20, where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. And those were the scriptures that I would cling to, and I would always tell myself, I can never outsend the grace of God. Oh, God, help me. Help me, God. And here I am, 29 years later. You see, guys, you got to understand something. When you're truly a child of God, even though you fail, he will prevail. I'm rapping. You hear me? We are on the winning side. Amen? So, there was a storm, but Paul believed the Lord. So he encouraged, right? And he made it to Rome, fulfilling his call. The centurion believed the owner, making a bad decision, the wrong decision, and sailed into lots of trouble, losing a lot. But God used Paul to save them. So God is using maybe me today to save you from a storm that can take the best out of you. So with that, I would, as a messenger of God, warn you. If it's not a storm that's going to develop you, that God is leading you to, listen, take heed to the word of God, lest you end up wasting everything. You hear me? Even losing your own life. If you're a non-believer. Maybe you're a believer, and there's some storms that you went into. God didn't lead you there because of the decisions that you made. Listen, I can tell you right now, repentance will get your life back. Well, maybe not the way you want it, but the life that God has for you will blow your mind away if you would just trust him, obey him, and repent. Amen? Let's pray.